Welcome back, Mr. Chimanaji joins us now, and your experience will help at this too, because you're professional in politics and you're also a legal practitioner. Now we've seen this. We did talk to Chief about what he will describe it as if he ends up in court, as I think he has already. Is it breach of trust, criminal breach of trust, or forgery? Have a listen to what Honorable Gumau said just now again.
I feel very sad about the mass hysteria in this country whenever issues come up. I don't think there has been a painstaking effort to really thoroughly investigate beyond the cacophony of voices of those who one way or the other may have been involved in this particular issue, to really sift the truth, to be able now to situate whether there is a criminal something there. You see, there is what people would, in legal terms, a presumption, whether rebuttable or what have you, in this country. Once they have mentioned, this man has done this, then you are guilty instantly. Just like Ole in the motor park, then you're already lynched. We need to refrain and go above the argument at the pedestrian level. A lot of ideas or concepts of what happened that have been bandied around, and some people chose pardon. And pardon is just an English word. In law, it's a slang at best that you added extra beyond what it ought to have been. That is, it's a slang. So if you ask me, the conversation should center on the argument that there is 100 billion naira approved or agreed by whatever arrangement for the National Assembly. That 100 billion naira, they say it is for constituency projects. The propriety is not even being questioned, because that is, everybody know that constituency project in Nigeria is a euphemism for corruption. Ordinarily, it should have been a beautiful thing that you are going to the National Assembly, you promise your people, perhaps you the area would have been forgotten, and that's the idea of representation. But if you go there, there's something that you bring home, you know, through the instrumentality of your own effort, for them to see that they are part and parcel of the Federation. So, on ordinary level, there's no problem about that. But it has become a euphemism for corruption, because we see that when these things are done, they are monetized. That's the argument, the argument there, that these things are monetized and people collect the money.
In all cases?
In most cases. How would I know whether it is on all cases?
Because some of them actually did say that no.
When
it started initially, they used to bring contractors who will go execute the job.
When there was fear of God, there was, you know, bribe in those days, you depict it by doing like this, they put it at the back. Bribe nowadays, you hold the person on the jugular and he drops it. I don't know whether you use gun self to collect it, even in uniform. So this is changing time. In those days, they were still testing. It was 10%. Bribe was 10% in kickback. But now it's 120%. Because you pay some deposit, they still chop the money appropriated for that. So when you now see that the National Assembly member or legislator is buying keke marua or keke napep, or buying sewing machines, or buying rice, or buying Okada, okay? I call it empowerment. And many of the people who they are giving are graduates, you know, university graduates, thereby reducing them to the, I don't know how to describe it, but these are constituency projects in their own estimation. Now, some of these things, if you evaluate them, they're about, let's say, $100,000. Now, they'll spend about $30,000 on media blitz to show that, to justify that one I collected, I have, you saw me on the television that I was spending it. So we should shift the conversation to the propriety of that money earmarked for them to spend. You understand? Because if you are talking about pardon, is the pardon within the confines of that 100 billion
That's what we're taking a look at, the process. What actually happened? Because these things are institutionalized, and if it's not corrected at that stage, are we going to make any headway?
That is why I'm saying that there is a cacophony of opinion there, and we need to have the facts, not from those who are themselves, you know, trying to defend themselves, because there is an ego problem now. Anybody who is in the National Assembly is on an ego trip, either to defend or rubbish another. But we need to go beyond that.
Some of them actually say, we need to probe this.
Because even a thief will say, well, look, let's go and find who stole this thing. But you'll be part of it. Until you are trying to get them, they want to die. Because the best way to manage change is either to bring it about or to control it. So if you say, we're going to... In fact, the man who went to petition ought not to have been the one to petition. Ordinarily.
Mr. Naji.
Because he had admitted by his own words that he was part of it, or he was also derelict.
The system we have is a tripartite system, so that they'll have checks and balances.
Yes.
Now, so the president does his budget proposal based,
theoretically at least, yes,
based on estimates of how much revenue is going to come in. You would have had the accountant general and all the other agencies tell them, okay, this is how much they're able to generate within this period for him to create that budget. So he brings it in, and the National Assembly, by reason of the constitution powers given to them, decides that, okay, this is what, looks at it and says, okay, go ahead or don't go ahead, tinker with this, don't tinker with that. So if it so happens that the House of Assembly decides that we need to take out this and add that part, who checks the House of Assembly?